Crow Zero, if you didn't gather, is a movie about absolutely beating up your rivals to within an inch of their life. The movie is an action-packed adrenaline rush that will wake up the inner rebellious teenager within you. The movie follows our protagonist, Takia Genji, as he is newly admitted to a school called Suzuran High. The schools in this universe are not institutes of education or learning. They are environments where the strongest fight to rule supreme over their underlings. What makes Crow Zero worth making a video about is the raw emotion that it leaves you with during and after it is concluded. It's no secret that I love shonen anime and manga. I love stories about characters who aspire to be more than what they are. This manga-based movie perfectly channels this ambitious spirit via our protagonist Genji, who aims to fight his way to the top of Suzuran High. He does so that he can become the strongest in his school. We witness Genji's battles throughout the movie, and we also see the consequences for continuing such a violent life through the implementation of the Yakuza in the movies. Crow Zero and its sequel Crow Zero 2 are among my favorite Japanese movies that I watched in my teenage years. It may be my nostalgia, but I still hold them in high regard. I want to convey why I love these movies and why I think they deserve your time. To bring some context to the world of Crow Zero, it's essential to understand what common characteristics and tropes Japanese delinquents have within Japanese media. Characters which follow this delinquent trope usually walk around with a huge chip on their shoulder. They get into fights with pretty much anyone who looks at them. They are exaggerated school bullies, the type of school student who just sits in the back of the classroom not paying attention. A Japanese delinquent is pretty easy to spot. They usually have dyed hair, which symbolizes their rebellious nature, school uniforms which have their sleeves torn, school jackets which are usually hanging off their shoulders, and crazy hairstyles which make them stand out. As to be expected, they behave in a disruptive manner, seeking not to conform to societal norms. They end up resorting to violence as a way to express their worth. A Japanese delinquent is referred to as a Yankee. This whole genre of Yankee movies, TV shows, and anime is something that I pretty much became obsessed with growing up. The series usually feature a protagonist who is misunderstood, but doesn't really do anything to help themselves. Crow Zero takes this Yankee concept and shows us a school overrun with delinquents. Instead of coming to school to study, they pretty much brawl and fight to prove their worth. They form rival gangs who fight each other in adrenaline-pumping scenes, which make you feel like joining in. Their egos and desires to be the strongest are coupled with the characters' urges for violence. This leads to them taking their brawls very seriously. Delinquency for a Yankee is pretty much a way of life. They don't do it for financial gain. They fight, vandalize, and hang out in public spots looking threatening as a pastime or as an act of rebellion. Crow Zero is a Yankee movie which features a protagonist thrown into Suzuran High, a school filled with delinquents who each are in their respective gangs. To become the top of any respective school, it's essential to form your own gang. However, to grow the number of members in your gang is a more difficult task. Recruitment through earning the respect of your opponents is essential to grow your own gang. Forming affiliations with other gangs to help in turf wars is also a requirement so that you're not outnumbered in a battle. And lastly, through gaining enough respect, other delinquents will voluntarily enlist themselves to fight for you. Once in a gang, the loyalty of a Japanese delinquent is second to none. They will fight to the death for their gang and its leader because of their sense of honor and brotherhood. For the sake of keeping their word to their boss, a delinquent will sacrifice anything and everything. Now that you know what a Japanese delinquent is, let's bring our attention over to the father of high school delinquents, Hiroshi Takahashi. He is a mangaka who is well renowned for creating some of the most popular manga based on delinquent high schoolers. He is most well known for his manga titled Crows and its sequel Worst, which is set in the same universe as Crows. His work is largely underrated in the West. The whole concept of Yankee series hasn't really kicked off on this side of the world. Even with series published in the popular magazine Shonen Jump like Rokudenashi Blues, these types of series never really picked up steam in the West. The exaggerated concept of delinquent youths is definitely something new to Western audiences. Hiroshi Takahashi's work was published in a rival magazine to Jump titled Shonen Champion. His work helped to convey the appeal of the typical Japanese delinquent through showing their brotherhood, determination to win, and their rare glimpses of kind-hearted nature, which helped to ground the characters in the series, giving them an air of relatability to the average misunderstood teenager. The Crows manga ran from 1990 to 1998. It inspired the live-action movies Crow Zero and Crow Zero 2. The movies take place before the events of the manga. The Crow Zero movies are a blend of Takahashi's manga along with the legendary director Takashi Miike. He is the key ingredient to the appeal of the Crow Zero movies, and what makes them feel like great standalone movies, even for people who may have never come across this delinquent genre or the Crows manga series. Miike is well known for his movies, Ichi the Killer, 13 Assassins, Audition, and Blade of the Immortal, movies which I highly recommend. His unique directorial style makes him perfect for adapting writing a manga or a comic book series. His movies usually begin with action that either has you gripped to his style or put off by it. You can really tell that he takes enjoyment in bringing to life a story via his unique comedic and violent style. Miike's style is a total exaggeration of tropes, whether to depict violence or comedy, his movies tend to have a larger-than-life style. That's why it works so well with a manga like Crows, which is set in reality, but it focuses on the rougher aspects of Japanese society. The manga brings attention to the youths of Japan who don't conform, and purposefully stand out with their appearance and mannerisms. Of course, comparing these movies to reality, you can see that it's a total exaggeration of the average Japanese delinquent, but Miike's style adapts the manga exaggerations with a cheesy charm. The backdrops and environments within the movies make the delinquents come to life. The school, Suzuran High, is covered in graffiti, trash, broken windows, and delinquents who fit perfectly into this environment. The level of attention in the set design will leave you wanting to read all of the graffiti littered in the background. Also, the way that Takashi Miike directs action is a sight to behold. The cinematography or camera work may not be for everyone, but I definitely think it works well for a manga-based movie like Crow Zero. The violent movement of the camera in Miike's movies complements the on-screen action. Each punch is delivered with a true sense of impact, and the violence can never feel like too much. Knowing the background behind the movies, I want to spend some time spoiler-free discussing the characters and stories which feature in both movies. The protagonist of Crow Zero is Genji Takia. He is the son of a Yakuza boss. He is enrolled into Suzuran High so that he can unify the opposing gangs so that they are under his control. His father challenges him, stating that if he cannot unify Suzuran, then he isn't worthy of taking over his father's position. The current top or leader of Suzuran is called Serizawa. Without any respect or recognition, Genji won't be taken seriously if he wishes to challenge Serizawa. So the story follows Genji building his own gang called GPS, as he fights and earns the respect of several strong gang leaders within the school. They eventually unify with Genji's gang to increase its size to a respectable level so that he can challenge Serizawa and his crew. Genji has a few struggles as he grows his own gang. He struggles to understand what it will take to become a leader, as well as dealing with the politics within the school and the value of brotherhood as his gang GPS grows. Also, during the movie, Genji is somewhat mentored by a former Suzuran student turned Yakuza member, Ken Katagiri. Ken misses his days at Suzuran, and it is clear he is reliving his golden days through mentoring Genji. Through Ken's character, we get to see a glimpse of the life that awaits the delinquents of Suzuran if they are recruited into the Yakuza. The story of Crow Zero is pretty easy to follow, and it's self-explanatory, not really requiring any prior knowledge coming into it. Amongst all of the action taking place, there are plenty of moments of comedic relief. Quite memorably, one particular scene where Genji is forced into a double date, which goes hilariously wrong. Genji's attitude is uptight and inconsiderate. He exudes self-confidence, which is backed up by his willingness to fight anyone who gets on his nerves. He has a short fuse and erupts over the smallest of indiscretions against him or his friends. For the most part, he ignores people he doesn't know or holds very little respect for. Genji takes himself overly seriously, and his ambitiousness to achieve his goal of conquering Suzuran brings some much needed depth to his character. We see his growth from a solo delinquent to a team player who cares for the well-being of his comrades. Serizawa, who is the current leader of Suzuran, appears calm and careless when he isn't fighting. He is described as a hobo for his tendency to walk around barefoot and pick up food off of the ground and eat it. But when it comes to fighting, he takes it as seriously as anyone else in this universe, also hating to lose just like Genji. Genji and Serizawa meet within minutes of the movie starting. A tense encounter as Serizawa is escorted away by the police, but both of them share a moment when they acknowledge each other. Genji looks at Serizawa sternly, like a lion looks at his prey, but in typical Serizawa style, he acknowledges Genji's glare, but responds with a carefree smile before leaving. This one moment is enough to introduce and give you an understanding of these two characters. They both fight in the movie's finale in a truly epic brawl, a fight which leaves you wanting more from this cast of characters. I remember watching the first movie and feeling pretty upset, like, was that it? I wanted to see more of these characters. I was pleasantly surprised to find out there is a sequel. What left me feeling speechless was the amount of fun that I had with this sequel. To this day, it stands as one of my favorite movies to watch. I guess it's like a guilty pleasure at this point. As good as the first movie is, Crow Zero 2 is literally the reason as to why I made this video. Taking place 8 months after the conclusion of the first movie, Crow Zero 2 brings back all of the familiar faces from the first movie, along with the introduction of new characters from a rivaling school called Hozen. After a pact of non-aggression between Suzuran and Hozen is broken, the two schools go to war with each other. If you thought that the gang battles in the first movie were epic, this movie just pushes the bar to a totally different level. The rivalry between the schools has some bloody history, which provides great context for their feud. Due to said context, which I don't want to spoil, it is in Hozen's best interest to really kick up a fuss, so they do what they can to enrage the students of Suzuran until the two schools schools meet in a grand epic school war. The sequel is also directed by Takashi Miike. His signature style is also present throughout this movie. This movie really pushes Genji's character, as he is dealing with an external threat, a conflict which will force him to unite suzerain to fight against. Genji's gang isn't enough to take on a whole school. His growth and moments of honesty within this movie are heartwarming. Moments which spend time to explore Genji's character are great downtime from the action. They serve to show us what problems Genji has and how he aims to overcome them. Hosen, the rival school in the second movie, requires all of the students to shave their heads aside from the gang leaders. They are known as the Skinhead Army, who are led by Narumi Taiga. The Skinhead Army is known for ambushing or destroying its enemies. The odds are always stacked high in this movie, as Hosen is brutally intimidating suzerain members throughout the movie leading up to its finale. The final battle between suzerain and Hosen is complete testosterone-fueled violence. Some say it goes on for too long, but I don't think the fights went on long enough. In a strange school gang version of Bruce Lee's Game of Death, suzerain members climb their way to the top of Hosen to face off against their boss, Narumi Taiga. Throughout the history of suzerain, as a school it has never been united. It's something that Genji's father challenged him to do, to unite the school as one. This is something that his own Yakuza father could not accomplish during his own time at suzerain. The problem is that within suzerain there are too many gang factions and cliques which each have their own reason for not wanting to unite as a school. Along the way, during his pursuit to get to the top, Genji gets caught up with fighting against a character called Rindaman, the strongest fighter within suzerain. He doesn't belong to any faction, he is a sole fighter, who Genji believes if he can defeat, then he will have proven his strength, and thus warrant the respect of the school to follow him. But of course, there is more to being a great leader than just strength and power. I recommend suspending your disbelief while checking these movies out. These characters take their lives as delinquents a little too seriously. They don't have any future prospects, need to study, or desire to be responsible. It can be a little questionable at first glance, but their over-the-top egotistical attitudes and pursuit for power, recognition, and friendship are these movies' redeeming qualities. Despite there being a lot to praise about these movies, there are moments when they can be lackluster and disappointing. It's only fair to mention the shortcomings of these movies, considering I'm recommending for you to watch them. Both movies feature a Yakuza subplot, which does bring some context to the lives of the delinquents after they leave suzerain, but these subplots achieve little more than just that. Ultimately, these subplots don't really lead anywhere, and would do little to affect the overall story if they weren't included. Also in the movies, Genji has a love interest called Ruka Aizawa. She is played by actress and singer Meisa Kuroki. She is the only female character in these movies, but she doesn't really do much other than console Genji when he is having a mood swing and perform some songs on stage. And just to add to this point, these movies have random cuts where J-pop and J-rock bands just start playing music suddenly. Sometimes a mellow song will play which might fit the tone of the story during that segment, but in other portions it just cuts to the pub where Genji is drinking and Meisa Kuroki performs one of her songs. Aside from this, the music during the movie and its fight scenes are really engaging and help to psych you up. It's just the musical numbers dotted throughout the movie which can feel questionable and jarring sometimes. Despite the problems with these movies, I still would recommend them to fans of anime, manga, and Japanese culture. There are moments within both of the movies which will make you cringe, as the cheesiness is unavoidable, but it doesn't take too long for you to forget and delve right back into the action. These movies, when you finish with them, will either leave you feeling like going to school, fighting the first person who looks at you the wrong way, or will leave you feeling bittersweet if you are past that stage in life. Looking at the cast at the end of Crow Zero 2, as they graduate, it will always leave me feeling empty. It may be a feeling of nostalgia for these movies, or remembering a time of no responsibility. These movies really do convey the feelings of being a naive, bashful youth, ready to take on the world. Whether if it is in the movies or in the manga, the dream of conquering suzerain high is comparable to the fleeting nature of youth. The students who dare to dream, to be at the top, fight and fight until their time comes to grow up, graduate, and enter into the adult world. Someone new will come to take their place and continue to fight their way to the top of suzerain. This cycle continues with the new generation. However, as adults, they will always look back fondly at the moments in which they flew freely like crows, without the cage of societal norms and responsibility inhibiting them. ずっといいじゃねえか。俺はカラスで十分だぜ。ありふれた闇とは俺どこへも行けずに立ち尽くすのか。このままじゃ俺が。